welcome to the latest DJ Mag Insight film with none other than the godfather of techno himself, Juan Atkins. The word legend is bandied about a lot, but Juan is a true legend, the originator of techno music, no less. Techno is now the number one genre on Beatport, number one selling genre, and has conquered the globe. But where would it be without Juan? Juan, welcome.
Thanks. Thank you.
I wanted to take you back, first of all, and ask you that, well, apparently your first instrument that you learned was the electric guitar, but it was actually your grandmother and her B3 organ that helped get you into synths.
Yeah. My grandma had this Hammond B3 organ that I used to come home when I was, second grade, almost like out of kindergarten. I used to come home and bang on this organ. I didn't know anything about music.
What sort of sounds did it have on it?
Organ. I mean, it had these bass keys that you can use your foot to play the bass.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And then it had some presets and had these sliders that you can. I don't remember exactly what the sliders were for, but all I know is that you can change the tone and things of that. And it's an organ, you know. It's organ. I don't know how many people would know how an organ sounds, but it makes organ sounds.
What did you like about those playing around on synths back
then? It was just that with a synthesizer, you can make all of these weird sounds, like UFO landing. If you could picture what a UFO, or imagine what a UFO would sound like landing in your backyard or something. These synthesizers made those sounds, what I thought were those sounds. And so it was just fascinating to be able to create basically anything that you could imagine, any type of sound, a sound wave that you could imagine. Fell in love with this Korg MS-10 that I would go in and, you know, it was like my favorite. It's like your favorite slot machine when you go to the casino, right? So this was my favorite keyboard when I went in there to play around, and I eventually was able to talk her into buying it for me. And so I took it home, and the thing about, I mean, it was monophonic. You couldn't play chords on it, you know. It was just all of these interesting sounds, and you can like use white noise to make drum sounds. Mm-hmm. So I wound up making my own drum kit from this Korg, one Korg MS-10. I mean, you can use like white noise or pink noise and filter it down and make a kick, a snare. You open the filter a little bit and make a snare, open it more, and you can make a hi-hat.
So you were spending hours with this thing.
Yeah, day in and day out.
So yeah, back in Detroit, you'd started a kind of DJ partnership with Derek May, hadn't you, your school buddy. But were Derek and Kevin a little bit in awe of you to start with, because you'd got into production early and they were kind of, they had?
Well, I went to high school. The thing is, I went to high school with Derek and Kevin. And Derek was actually my best mate, as you would say, or best friend, actually, during high school. And so he more or less was always there. I mean, although they were always into sports. Mm. They played football, but I was the musician. Mm. So I was always in the music class when they were on the field, you know. But with Derek, I became friends with Kevin through Derek because they were in the same class. And it was actually my younger brother, Aaron, that kind of had me involved with Derek and Kevin because they were in his class. They were like a year or two under me. Mm. And so that's really, I met them through my brother. And
but then you started DJing together, doing little
Yeah, we just, you know, because Derek had moved to Detroit, and while we were still living in Belleville, And so he started getting associated with different party scenes and things like that. And eventually we were always together, like musically. Mm. You know, we were always like synced, you know, because this tape that I was listening to, like this Kraftwerk and stuff like this, Telex, and Derek was like crazy about this tape. And so that's how we connected musically. Mm. And so we just kind of like, we were friends and we hung out, and it was like we were getting approached by these social clubs in Detroit to do parties, like they do these one-off parties. So we eventually got into DJ. I mean, it was like anybody that was doing creative and into music, you were going to be a DJ eventually. Mm. You know? Class in high school called Future Studies, and the reference book to that class was called Future Shock, which was the Alvin Toffler book, and it was all about the transformation from an industrial society to a technological society. And so, you know, technology, the word techno comes from the word technology. Mm-hmm. and it was just sort of it was like he had a chapter in the book called Techno Rebels, and it was about, and when I read that, I'm like, okay, that sounds fitting.
Yeah, yeah.
For what I'm doing with this music, because it was like everything that was the new, I mean, all of the music was totally electronic. It was nothing acoustic or nothing conventional about what I was doing. So I felt like just, I put two and two together, and like, it was like, you know, okay, this is the technological age coming forth. So this is what I'm a part of.
I was chatting to Eddie Flash and Folks a little while ago, and he was painting this picture of a few kind of like escapades that some of you guys would have, involving kind of like car chases and sort of, well, he said a bit of stolen gear that, was around.
Yeah,
but he didn't really go into proper detail. But did you have some kind of like adventures in Detroit?
Yeah, man, well? We had adventures. It was adventures every day in Detroit, and it was like that right there is a story in itself, and which actually lends to the whole movement.
Yeah, yeah.
Because if it wasn't for let me just say that this musical gear that dropped out of heaven.
Mm, yeah. And some of it was...
A lot of these guys wouldn't be making music. And
some of it had been made for the kind of rock bands or whatever, and they discarded it and they turn up in junk or secondhand shops.
Well, yeah, I guess that's a good way to keep the cover until... I guess until the film and the book comes out.
When's the film coming?
Well, I mean, we've been working on this for years, and I mean, different. All of us have had our own ideas and starting projects, I don't know why it hasn't come together definitively yet, we're close, and. Everybody has their own story to tell as well, and sees things from their own perspective, and that's quite interesting as well. But eventually, I think it's a story that needs to be told, and eventually it will be.
I guess he ain't about to play, because y'all didn't sound like y'all were ready.
One time, Derek couldn't pay his rent, so he had to sell one of these 909 drum machines to be able to get money to pay the rent. So Jeff Mills was in the market for trying to get one of these drum machines, because we had used this drum machine as a secret weapon in a DJ battle. Mm-hmm. there was deep space versus direct drive. And what our advantage was, we knew about this music gear. You know, this was early. I had an 808. I had like probably the first 808, TR-808 drum machine to come off the press in America. And so we took this TR-808 drum machine to the party and played rhythm beats on it, and it just blew the crowd away. We won the competition hands down. So of course, any other DJs that was checking us out wanted to incorporate this drum machine in their show. So Jeff Mills was one of the guys who wanted to buy this 909. And I told Derek, I said, Derek, you can't sell it to Jeff because that's our crosstown competition.
Deadly rival.
Exactly. Friendly rival.
Friendly rival.
But so he took it to Chicago to sell it because his parents had moved to Chicago. So he was going back and forth to Chicago, and he had got friends with the Hot Mix DJ and imports and set. He took this drum machine and sold it to Frankie Knuckles. And Frankie Knuckles was his protege was Chip E. And Frankie and Chip E took this 909 and made like this and some of those early Chicago house records. And it kind of like, it was like one of the things that kind of the catalyst to kind of like made Chicago kind of permeate.
Did you kind of make a decision at the time with your music to not go down a kind of soul route, like you could say house is a bit more soul based or whatever? You want to go down the soundscapes thing?
No, this is the thing about house music versus techno the thing about Chicago was when you had the disco era going, like all of the radio stations had changed formats to be disco stations. But then 82, 83 rolled around and they killed the format. But Chicago held on to it. And so when every other radio station in the country stopped doing disco and disco's dead, Chicago's still going strong, you know? But the thing is that the only disco type music at this time was like Philly International International Records. And it was, to me, their records were emulating this past style. And that was the only thing that it was like, okay, you know, our stuff was looking forward and they were, to me, looking backward.
So when, for instance, Joey Buttram's Energy Flash record came out, were you down with that?
Yeah.
You like it?
Yeah.
And then what about when the kind of UK hardcore techno stuff started speeding everything up a bit and getting a bit more mental, should we say? Were you down with that?
It was a time when, I don't know the difference. I know that, what was it, the GABA music came?
Yeah, that was going to be my next
point. Yeah. And that was kind of a turn off. But...
What was that? Was it too
fast? It was just
bonkers.
Yeah, it was just, it wasn't, it started, that became a time when eventually, I guess this was going to happen, when the technology enabled people that shouldn't make music able to make music. And I think that's something that, you know, that kind of came to the forefront at the time, which it was like an expansion. Now I think we're contracting a little bit, but.
So when you heard some GABA stuff, did you think, my God, what would we?
Well, I mean, it was associated with fascism and
oh yeah, and
yeah, man, like, people yeah. were doing Zig Heils at the shows and stuff like that, and I'm like, well, I'm not trying to be a part of that, but at the same time, you know, I mean, I'm all for evolution of music, and I mean, it doesn't always go. Yeah. in the direction that I would like to see or like it, but I would rather have the evolution than not. I mean, you know, I would like to see people explore all different, you know, different ways to go, you know, different avenues, but I'm glad that didn't last that long.
Okay, so how did you feel when Europop Act 2 Unlimited?
And then... Well, let me go back a little bit. Now here's the next thing, and this was an interesting progression, and you had to be there to understand this progression. Along with when Chicago, you know, you can remember that Chicago, after our records were being so popular in Chicago with all of this weird technology synth stuff, they came with Acid House. And they called it Acid House because they couldn't call it techno.
Yeah.
Because of course that would be giving us our props or respect, whatever. So they called it acid, which was techno, but it was their version. Mm. And
more 303 maybe.
Yeah. And what that eventually evolved to was that they started, I don't know who did this, Tyree or either Chip, started putting hip hop beats under the acid track. And so they came with hip house. Mm. And if you listen to hip house, that was the precursor to a lot of what they call the rave culture and the break beat and Shut Up and Dance and those companies and then that kind of evolved into the jungle. So that was an interesting trend. Mm. How that went.
Yeah. Jungle techno.
Yeah.
Music history is littered with music genres that were kind of started off by black guys before being co-opted by white guys, jazz, blues, house even, and with techno, the superstar DJs now are kind of like these guys such as...
Is history repeating itself?
Richie Horton, Sven, Adam Beyer. If you Derek and Kevin were three white guys, where would you be now, do you think?
Probably would have so much money that we probably wouldn't deserve and probably be crazy by now. So, you know, sometimes things I guess weren't, you know, I mean, I don't know, man. That's to me the way to look at it. I mean, I think that we would definitely, basically, just to keep it on a basic level, I think we'd be more, you know, bigger than we are now.
But in terms of Europe, it seemed like Europe embraced you guys as being pioneers and doing cool stuff. But in America, you're kind of almost airbrushed out of history. Not recognized for a long time.
Well, that's the thing about America, and that was one of the things that I noticed. When I came to the UK, the first thing that I noticed that there was no place that you can basically go. Like wherever I went in the UK, you could always see white and black people. Mm. Whereas there's places you can go in the US and you don't see no black people. Mm. Or there's some certain neighborhoods, certain places you can go in Detroit and in US where you see no white people. Mm. Like when my high school, I think it was only one white kid in my high school. Mm. And it was like a couple thousand students or more, you know? So it's so polarized, is so polarized that white America could be doing something and the black America have no clue and vice versa. Mm. Cause it's, because you know they don't even have to mix with each other unless they want to.
1 or 2 years ago, we were hearing this thing about the Belleville 3 kind of reunion, reforming. You got the three of you were going to do gigs together and stuff, and it kind of hasn't really happened yet. How come?
It's you know, just on a basic level, man, it's kind of hard to keep three egos the size of our ego together in the same room, let alone doing a tour and anything together.
You mean you keep falling out?
Yeah. To be honest, I think it's everybody has their own way of seeing things and own perspective on how things should be done, and everybody has strong characters and strong opinions, and we're used to doing things the way we want and sticking to our guns, and when you
because you've been not on the individual same artists for so
yeah
long,
yeah
so.
when you know and it's like nobody wants to be humble, nobody wants to take the step back, you know. Team is that you gotta compromise, you know, and you know it's hard, you know.
So are more shows gonna happen? Because there were 1 or 2 shows you did, didn't there, but are there gonna be more?
If it was up to me, I would like to see more. It's not totally up to me, it's up to 2 other guys, it's 2 other egos.
So what's the main sticking point? Is it over who's gonna play which
tune? I just think that, you know, I don't really wanna elaborate on that too much.
Sure, yeah.
You know, I have my ideas of why, yeah. But you know, I'll just say, and maybe even myself included a little bit, that some people feel better off by themselves than they do together.
But techno is the number one selling genre on Beatport. Do you feel kind of some kind of proud of this thing that you've helped give birth to?
Well, yeah, of course. I mean, yeah, that's good. I mean, you know, I didn't know they were number one genre, but you know, that's good. It shows that the experiment worked. You know,
good
like
work.
100 times better than I imagined.
Thanks for your amazing contribution.
Thank you. Thanks.
And for talking to us today. Cheers,
okay.
One.
Thanks.